100 commuters are trying to get from the suburbs to downtown, and they have 5 roads they can use to accomplish that task. 3 of them are wide highways. They are so wide, in fact, that the number of cars on them will not materially impact travel times. For the bottom and the top one, they will take 15 minutes to traverse. The connector in the middle is fast and will only take 2 minutes. The remaining 2 roads are more narrow. As a result, the number of cars on them determine travel times. More specifically, the number of minutes each takes to traverse is n divided by 10, where n is the number of cars on those roads. For example, if all 100 commuters decide to take one of those roads, it will take 10 minutes to go across. If only 50 of them were, it would take 5 minutes, and so forth. Here is your rather unusual puzzle. I'm going to give you a single road closed sign. I want you to put it somewhere on this map, and by doing so, magically decrease the amount of time it's going to take these commuters to get from the suburbs to downtown. That's right. You can close one of these roads and somehow, some way, decrease the amount of time it takes to get from point A to point B. And while you think about that, check out some of these cool books that I've written. Your hint for today comes out of Chapter 1, Lesson 1 of Game Theory 101, The Complete Textbook. It turns out all you need to solve this problem is a knowledge of dominated strategies, and you're going to be looking for an application of the prisoner's dilemma. Are you ready for the answer? Let's start out by working on the commute without the road closed sign to get a better understanding about what the incentives are here. Imagine that you had taken the bottom road at the beginning, and you arrive at this junction. What should you do? Well, if you take the connector and then take the wider road up top, you'll spend 17 minutes getting to downtown from this point. If you continue down the narrow road, you'll spend n divided by 10 minutes. While your travel time depends on the number of cars going down that road with you, it actually does not affect your preference here. Even if every single other car took that narrow road, you would only spend 10 minutes going to downtown. That's better than the 17 minutes of going through the connector. So at this point, you definitely want to take the more southern route to finish your trip to downtown. What if you had taken the narrow route at the beginning? Well, if you continue going in the northern route, you'll spend 15 minutes to get to downtown. If you go through the connector and then on to the other narrow road, you'll spend 2 minutes plus n divided by 10 minutes to complete your trip. And while the number of other drivers following that narrow route will impact your total travel time, it does not change your preference. Even if every other car were on that road, you would spend 12 minutes to complete your trip through that way, which is better than the 15 minutes that you would spend by going the northern route. So you will definitely, from this point, want to make the transition back to the narrow road to finish your trip to downtown. Putting those two pieces of information together, we can make an important inference. That wide highway in the top right will never be used. We might as well ignore its existence entirely. With that out of the way, think about the commuters' incentive as they are leaving the suburbs. They know that eventually they want to reach the center-bottom junction. The question is, what is the fastest way of getting there? If they take the wide highway, they'll spend 15 minutes to reach that junction. If they take the narrow road, they'll spend n divided by 10 minutes plus 2 minutes to get there. Again, even if every single other car goes through the narrow road, that travel time of 10 plus 2 or 12 minutes will still be better than taking the wide highway. As a result, once more, we can ignore effectively the existence of the highway at all. And thus we have found the travel route for every single one of these commuters. They'll begin their journey from the suburbs going down the narrow route. When they hit the junction, they will go through that fast transition point to get to the other narrow road, at which point they will complete the trip to downtown. Because every single car is doing this, we have n as being 100 for each of those narrow routes, and as a consequence, the total travel time for everyone involved is 22 minutes. What we're seeing here is that the narrow routes are dominant strategies. There's no reason to use the wide highways when the narrow routes will still be better for you regardless of how many cars are on them. It also means that this is not a particularly interesting strategic problem, because you don't actually have to anticipate what others are doing to formulate your best strategy. Can we do better than that? Let's try closing off the connector road. If you go north to begin with, you have to finish north. If you go south to begin with, you have to finish south. The next step to work through is how commuters would adapt to that road closure. Clearly, they're all not going to go north. If they were to do that, we would have 10 minutes in the first step plus 15 minutes in the second step. That's 25 minutes in total. And it would be very easy for just a single commuter to decide to go south instead. And if he does, he gets to blaze through there. 15 minutes in the first bit, and then because he's the only one driving in the last bit, it's virtually instantaneous for him to get to downtown. Indeed, what has to happen here if we have that connecting road closed is an even distribution of the cars going north and south. That means 50 in total going north, 50 in total going south. The cars going north will spend 50 divided by 10 minutes on the first bit, which is 5 minutes in total, and 15 minutes in the second bit. The cars going south will spend 15 minutes on the first bit, and then 50 divided by 10 minutes on the second bit, which is 5 minutes, plus that 15, is 20 minutes. Notice that no driver has any incentive to switch over to the other side, because if they do that, they would be going from 20 minutes to their destination to slightly more than 20 minutes. But notice what that means. If we have a travel time of 20 minutes, then we have officially done better by closing that connecting road. How on earth is that possible? The key thing to realize is that every car that goes down the wide highway is providing a positive externality to all other cars. By taking myself off one of the narrow roads, I'm allowing every car that remains on the narrow road to travel just a little bit faster. The problem is that each of us has no individual incentive to take one of those wide highways. That's because even if everyone is going to be taking one of the narrow roads, the 10 minutes to travel along it plus the 2 minutes to take the connector road is still going to be faster individually than taking one of those 15-minute wide highways. In essence, this is the defect strategy of a classic prisoner's dilemma. Because each of us is pursuing our individual interests, these narrow roads are heavily taxed by vehicles. And as a consequence, they are not as fast as they could be. In contrast, closing down the connecting road forces individuals to cooperate. That's because it is no longer possible for any one individual to take both of the narrow routes. You either go north or you go south. As a consequence, the workload is evenly distributed between the two routes, and in turn, travel times are going down for everyone. This is an application of something known as Braess's paradox, named after the researcher that discovered it. The basic idea is that more complex systems are not inherently better at distributing workloads. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please leave me a comment below and like, share, and subscribe. And I'll see you next time. Take care.